So good morning and welcome to the new SCOC virtual lecture series. I will be the chair today. My name is Maria Colometache, for the ones that do not know me, and I am a group leader at the ICB in Munich at the Institute of Computational Biology. So today I'm extremely happy to introduce to you Dominique Grün. Dominique studied theoretical physics in Cologne, and he also did his PhD there in theoretical physics. And after that, he moved into the biology field, and he worked at the Max Delbruck Center in Berlin and at the Hubrecht Institute in Utrecht. And he's now a group leader at the Max Planck Institute of Immunology and Epigenetics. And the title of today's talk from Dominique is Revealing Dynamics and Gene Expression Variability in Cell State Space. Please, I remind you, if you have questions, you can use the raise hand option, and at the end of the talk, I would list you and I will ask you to unmute. I think unmute your microphone. You can also type questions on the question tab or on the chat, although better on the questions tab. And I wanted also to remind you that in 2 weeks, in the next seminar, we will have Celia Martinez Jimenez from the Pioneer Campus here in Munich that will give the next talk. And now, Dominique, the floor is yours, and I will mute my microphone.
Yes, thank you, Maria, very much for the introduction and also for the opportunity to present here. So this is a great lecture series. And anyway, it's a great platform for a community building, I find. So I try to share my screen now. Hope this works. Can you see my screen and the presentation?
Yeah, we can. Perfect.
Okay, great. So I would like to tell you about our work on deciphering the role of gene expression variability during cell differentiation. And first, I would like to remind you that cell fate decision is a crucial process during development, where a pluripotent zygote gives rise to a complex multicellular organism by a series of cell fate decisions. This is very obvious, but it's also clear that cell fate decision is very important in the maintenance and the turnover of adult organ tissues, such as the intestine or the liver. For example, the intestine is composed of an epithelium that is organized in this crypt villus-like structure, where the stem cells sit at the bottom of the crypt and continuously give rise to a variety of cell types that undergo constant turnover. And with the help of single-cell RNA sequencing in particular, we have learned to discriminate these cell types. And we typically do that by performing unsupervised grouping of the cells into clusters that represent groups of transcriptomically similar cells. And these could be abundant cell types or rare cell types. But we all know that we can go a step further and we can actually organize these transcriptomes into manifolds that should reflect lineage trees. So in that case, for example, we would find the intestinal stem cell at the apex and the mature cell types at the bottom, and they are connected by a series of progenitor stages that can be separate or shared between lineages. Due to the massive development in the field, we can now not only interrogate the transcriptome, but also other layers of information. For example, we can profile the epigenome by a single-cell ATAC-seq or by single-cell HiSeq. We can also profile cell surface proteins or lineage relations using barcoding systems. And also, we can have a look at how the cells are localized within the tissue by using spatial transcriptomic technologies. So during my work as a postdoc, and of course, and also later on in my lab, we've developed methods for characterizing single-cell transcriptome landscapes, and we came up with the RACE-ID method for the identification of rare cell types in particular. And later on, with the STEM-ID method, we were able to predict lineage trees and actually also predict the stem cell identity within the lineage tree, because this is not always known a priori. So when we talk about stem cell differentiation, we envision the stem cell or the multipotent cell type more generally, not as an individual, deterministic object, so defined by its transcriptome, but rather as an ensemble of metastable states that are all transcriptomically biased towards the different lineages in the systems. And as long as there is no commitment, transitions between these states are possible at different probabilities until there is a signal that could come from the microenvironment or as a response to a stochastic fluctuation of a lineage determining factor that leads to commitment towards one of these lineages. So in 2018, we actually published a method where we aimed to identify these fate-biased states, which should be localized within the multipotent progenitor compartment. And multipotent progenitors, so these metastable states, we would not expect them to be like very distinct, but rather discriminated by subtle transcriptomic differences. So they're not easily learned by approaches such as clustering. So the idea of the fate ID method was actually to start with the cell types that we can characterize well, which are the mature states in the system, and then actually learn the identity of the multipotent cells in an iterative fashion from these mature cell states. And in a nutshell, this was done by applying a random forest analysis. So here we start with the mature cell types, then actually we pick a subsample of cells and a random sample of features of genes, and we build a decision tree based on these features. And then actually we can run the unclassified cells through that decision tree and come up with a vote for a cell lineage. And in random forests, the feature is that you actually don't do that a single time, but you do that many, many times by sampling many different subsamples of cells and of genes. And this way you build hundreds of decision trees. And then we interpret the fraction of votes for a given lineage for a given cell as a lineage probability. And the other important feature of that method of fate ID is that we are not doing that in one go, but we actually perform that in an iterative fashion. So we stay local in cell state space. We basically start to classify the cells that are close to our initial training set, and then infer a lineage probability for these cells. Then we join them into the training set, and we proceed this way in an iterative fashion. So we again classify the neighboring cells, and then this way we also move along with the training set. Along the differentiation trajectory, if you want, backward in differentiation pseudo-time. And we only stop if we have classified all the cells, and in the end, we have a lineage probability for each of these cells. And we applied that method initially to the hematopoietic tree. So briefly, in the hematopoietic system that makes the blood, the hematopoietic stem cell sits at the apex and gives rise to multipotent progenitors, which branch off into myeloid progenitors and lymphoid progenitors. And the myeloid progenitors give rise to red blood cells and white blood cells, such as granulocytes and monocytes. And the lymphoid progenitors give rise to all the different lymphoid lineages. And this was our initial data set of mouse hematopoietic cells, and the gray cells in the middle would be the multipotent cells, and the colored clusters here are the more mature cell types or states that you can actually discriminate very well by clustering. But these multipotent for these multipotent progenitors, which are very similar to each other, clustering is very bad in discriminating and showing differences between between different substates in this population. But running fate ID, we could reveal that there is indeed different substates within that cloud. So for example, here we have B-cell biased lymphoid progenitors, and they kind of overlap with progenitors towards the plasmacytoid dendritic cell lineage. Then we have granulocyte biased progenitors and red blood cell biased progenitors. And one important insight of that study was that actually there seems to be a common progenitor of plasmacytoid dendritic cells and B cells, which is surprising given the fact that B cells are actually antibodies secreting adaptive immune cells, while PDCs are actually part of the innate immune response, and they produce type 1 interferon in response to sensing viral RNA. And they were believed to be of myeloid origin, but our study suggested that they are of lymphoid origin. So we tried to validate that and investigate that functionally by actually identifying marker genes that correlate with PDC fate bias versus B cell fate bias. And then we sorted subpopulations with differential fate bias towards B cells and PDCs. And by a cell culture, so in vitro differentiation assays, we actually confirmed the predicted fate bias ratio between B cells and PDCs in these different populations. And the shared origin of PDCs and B cells was then actually confirmed by more in-depth follow-up studies that were published later. So now we believe that we are able to discriminate these fate-biased states. And now we would like to study the role of gene expression variability in the process of differentiation. So gene expression variability or variability of a cell state space is a consequence of gene expression variability, which could eventually lead to fluctuations in the cell state and to transitions from one lineage to another lineage at variable probabilities throughout differentiation. So gene expression noise is a consequence of the constant binding and unbinding of transacting factors to the promoter of a gene. And only if a transcription factor is bound, the polymerase can become active and produce mRNAs from a gene locus. And when it's unbound, there is transcriptional silence. And this gives rise to this bursting pattern of transcriptional activity over time. On top of that, there are also more deterministic sources of variability, such as the cell cycle and variations in the microenvironment. So is gene expression noise now known to be important during differentiation? So there are examples in the literature, for example, during mouse embryogenesis, there is this mutual repression of GATA6 and NANOC in the inner cell mass of the embryo. And this is a B-stable system. And in response to FGF signaling, either NANOC can take over or GATA6 can take over. And eventually, each cell will acquire either a GATA6 positive cell state or a NANOC positive cell state. And by segregation, then these cells will separate into the primitive endoderm and the epiblast cells. Another example comes from earlier work by Arjun Raj when he was in the lab of Alexander van Oudenaarden, where they used C. elegans as a model. And they looked at the intestinal specification pathway. So the cell lineages in C. elegans are very well characterized. And there is actually like one precursor cell that gives rise to the intestinal lineage. The gene regulatory network that regulates this process is also characterized. And upstream of that network is the gene SCN1. So they used SCN1 mutants, and then they actually found that if they mutate this gene, then END1, which is a crucial specification gene, becomes highly variable. And then they modeled this and came up with the conclusion that only if that one expression crosses a certain threshold during differentiation, then actually ALT2 can become activated and the worms can develop an intestine. And otherwise, they would not be able to develop an intestine. So this is an example of partial penetrance in response to gene expression variability. So if you would like to study that systematically, we need to be able to quantify gene expression variability locally in cell state space. So what do we need for this? So the first thing that we need is a local homogeneous neighborhood in cell state space. So cells can actually be compared to each other. And there are actually methods that can in principle do this. For example, there is a meta-cell analysis from the lab of Amos Tanai. And here the core idea is to first come up with a balanced k-nearest neighbor graph that connects cells with high mutual similarity. And then to partition this graph into modules of high mutual similarity. And then these modules are actually also pruned by removing outliers. But this only uses an ad hoc criterion and not a generative model to test the purity of the cells within that module. So the second challenge that we need to tackle is the dependence of the variance on the mean. So if you consider raw UMI counts, and then it is known that actually they follow more or less a sampling distribution plus some additional sources of noise. And this leads to a monotonically increasing dependence of the variance on the mean. And if you would like to compare noise or variability across neighborhoods, we need to be able to deconvolute this systematic dependence, because otherwise we don't really have a means to compare noise levels across neighborhoods if the mean expression changes as well. So there's also been work along these lines. Many of you might know the BASICS package, which is a full Bayesian model for the description of gene expression variability. So this actually models both technical and biological variability and also performs data normalization. So it has a large number of parameters and also requires a large number of cells to actually infer these parameters. And actually, in the end, it allows only comparison between two cell populations. So this is not really well suited to derive noise estimates across a large number of individual neighborhoods. So now, what is our approach to that problem? And this is the VAR-ID method that was published earlier this year. So we start out with the k-nearest neighbor graph and then try to come up with a k-nearest neighbor graph that is actually consistent with cell state transitions. And I'm going to tell you later what I mean by this in detail. But we start out with a pretty common approach. So we first normalize our transcriptomes, and we use a normalization scheme that is similar to the SC-transform method that was published at the end of last year by Christoph Hafemeister and Rahul Satija, where a negative binomial regression on the total UMI counts in each cell is performed, and then the Pearson residuals of this regression are used to compute a PCA, and their nearest neighbors are inferred using the Euclidean distance on these Pearson residuals, as on the PCA components of these Pearson residuals. So this is very similar to also what Sierra is doing, and this gives us the k nearest neighbors for each cell. So now we have this graph, but we have to be aware that global transcriptome similarity does not imply that there could be a transition between connected cells. And actually, we would be able to tell this if we had a model of gene expression variability that allows us to statistically assess whether the gene expression level observed in a cell is consistent with the expectation according to this model. And we have shown in our 2014 paper that we can model the raw UMI count distribution very well by a negative binomial distribution. Now let's focus on such a neighborhood, and for simplicity, we assume we have only three nearest neighbors, and they're here connected to the green central cell. Now, given the mean variance dependence at an estimate of the mean expression in the central cell, you can actually come up with this background distribution because it's uniquely determined by the mean variance dependence. And now for each gene, we can interrogate the probability of this genes according of this gene according to this background model. And if a gene is very far in the tail and has a very low probability, this could imply that no transition is indicated between the central cell and the connected cell. And this also allows us to assign a probability to each of these links. And if the probability according to this background model is very low, we can decide to prune this link as we think it does not imply a cell state transition. So there could be, despite of global similarity, strong expression differences of individual genes. And to those of you who are familiar with immunology, one example could be ILCs, innate lymphocytes and T cells, which share very similar transcription factor profiles and cytokine profiles, yet the T cells do express the T cell receptor and the innate lymphocytes do not. So T cell receptor genes could be such example that really distinguish these two different cell types. And there is no direct transition possible between these cell types. So now, based on these probabilities, we can prune this network and remove the links that we don't believe represent possible cell state transitions. And so we can use now this pruned k-nearest neighbor network, first of all, to improve our cell type detection. And here I'm using data of mouse hematopoietic cells that were published 2 years ago by Miroslav Sokolovsky and Lauren Klein in Nature. And here you can see again that the multipotent progenitors are in the center, and they're connected to an arm of neutrophils and of erythrocytes and all the other lineages in the system. So megakaryocytes, B cells, monocytes, basophils, and so on. And obviously, we detect many more clusters, or not many more, but some more clusters as compared to if you perform community detection, so we use the Lovan clustering method on the full k-nearest neighbor network. So do these clusters make sense? So in order to assess this, we looked into the expression of known marker genes in the hematopoietic system across all these clusters. And I'm just showing a few examples here. So in the B-cell compartment, if we use a pruned K-nearest neighbor network, we were able to resolve common lymphoid progenitors from more advanced B-cell progenitors. We also resolved substates within the eosinophil compartment and across megakaryocyte states. So what we can also now do, given these link probabilities, is actually to derive transition probabilities between clusters, assuming that we can diffuse on this pruned K-nearest neighbor graph. And these lineage probabilities are now highlighted here by these gray links. And again, the multipotent progenitor is placed very much in the center by this analysis, and basically connects to all the lineages in the system as expected. And furthermore, we see that these links reflect the known relations between progenitor states along these lineages. Now we can come back to the actual goal, namely to quantify gene expression variability locally. We do have these homogeneous neighborhoods, and we can just compute the variance of gene expression within these neighborhoods, so only across the neighbors that remain after pruning. I mentioned initially that this is the problem of this systematic mean variance dependence. So again, we here model combined technical and biological noise of raw UMI counts, because we know that these data follow a negative binomial distribution, and we don't put in any assumptions on the characteristics of the technical noise. Also, modeling the combined noise has the advantage that we are reducing the parameters, and in the end, we only want to be able to tell differences in the variability levels. And we don't really have the goal to quantify biological noise, which is a much more tricky topic. But considering combined noise, it's very clear that we can model this dependence actually by a convex function. So we use the second order polynomial, which we fit to the baseline of this cloud, to the baseline level of noise. And if you regress that out, you obtain an estimate of what we call corrected variance or noise. And this is the quantity that we can compare across neighborhoods. So first, we performed a simulation to see how good we are in predicting noise levels. So we simulated three different populations based on differential expression. And then in one population, we also changed the noise level of a fraction of genes. And then it turned out that depending on the mean expression, we are more or less able to predict differential noise. So if so here they are ranked by expression, so the most highly expressed genes, if they're differentially noisy, we can detect this very well. But then if you move towards low expression, so in that case below a mean expression of 0.5, we have much more genes where we cannot detect noise differences. And we compared that then more systematically, and actually using filtering based on the noise fold change. So if you only look at genes with a fold change greater than 1.25 and with an expression level greater than 0.5, we actually have a very good ability to discriminate true positives, and we have a very low rate of false positives then. So we have an almost perfect ability to recover these noise differences. And actually, when we determine differential noise between two populations, we use a Wilcoxon test of the differential noise estimates across all neighborhoods. So this was the technical background. So now what actually tells us about biology. So for this, we now looked into the multipotent progenitors of the hematopoietic system, and we computed differentially noisy genes. First of all, we compared them to differentially expressed genes. And obviously, there's only limited overlap. So that also speaks for the fact that we successfully removed this mean variance dependence. Now here, I'm pointing to this, these expression levels of these noisy genes in the multipotent progenitors. And by eye, you can already see that they look quite variable. Some of them become upregulated along the neutrophil differentiation trajectories, and others become upregulated in other lineages. And here I'm showing you the noise level itself. So they're apparently noisy in the multipotent progenitors, and then some of them remain noisy on the neutrophil trajectory, some others remain noisy on the erythrocyte trajectory. So what are these genes that have enhanced noise levels? So for this, we intersected the differentially noisy genes with transcription factors, and then we constructed a gene regulatory network of these transcription factors. And to our surprise, we found that in this network, the different lineage determining factors reappear. So we have determining factors of megakaryocytes over here, of lymphocytes, and of monocytes. And also we have obviously some factors that are involved in in maintaining the HSC state. So that means that these lineage determining networks have variable activity already in the multipotent progenitor compartment. And this could correspond to the metastable states that I have explained at the beginning of the talk. Sorry, what's going on here? So next, we can also ask what happens during differentiation. So how do noise levels change in comparison to expression levels? For this, we focused on the neutrophil differentiation trajectory. And myeloperoxidase is a marker of neutrophil differentiation, and consistently you can see that this is continuously upregulated during neutrophil differentiation. On the other hand, the noise is actually suppressed. So as it becomes upregulated, expression becomes very stable. However, variability is prevailing in the multipotent progenitor compartment and to some extent also on the erythrocyte branch. So this was one example, but we can actually see is there are genes that have a co-regulated noise profile. So for this, we ordered genes as the cells pseudotemporally along that trajectory and then clustered noise profiles into modules using self-organizing maps. And here you can see that there's very different behaviors. For example, we have genes that have initially high noise and higher noise at terminal differentiation, but also there are other genes that have increased noise at intermediate stages. So I'm showing you here a few examples to point out an interesting observation, namely that in some cases where genes are regulated in a similar way based on their expression, the noise behavior could be very different. So in module 14 and in module 11, genes are continuously upregulated, yet the noise looks different. So in module 14, the noise saturates at higher level, while in module 11, the noise decreases eventually. And this could indicate that there might be a critical point in the covariance of gene expression driving commitment. So where genes become very noisy, like in a phase transition, basically, and then the order of the system is changed. So of course, this is a hypothesis, but this is one of the questions that we are currently looking into. And also to point out that these are not random groups of genes. We performed pathway enrichment analysis. And for example, here in module 2, we found that these genes are highly enriched in specific pathways, such as RNA splicing and metabolic pathways. So to also show that you can pick up the signal that actually tells us about biology, we further applied the VAR-ID method then to perturbation data that were published in the same study. So here, mice were treated with erythropoiesis, which leads to an expansion of erythrocytes at no change in overall hematopoietic cell count in the bone marrow. So we took the data from the ipo-treated mice and co-analyzed them with the wild-type data. And first of all, you can see that in most of the populations, the cells intermingle very well. And only on the GATA-positive erythrocyte branch, there is a separation into subpopulations that are dominated by wild-type cells or EPO-treated cells. So we determined the differentially variable genes between these two populations. And again, there's only very, very limited overlap with the differentially expressed genes. So that means that the information we get from the differentially variable genes, we would not be able to retrieve from the differentially expressed genes. So here I'm showing you the heat maps of these genes. So you can see that there is differential noise between these EPO-treated cells and the wild-type cells. This is also visible if you just look at the expression. Some of these genes, they are also noisy in other populations. and in particular on the neutrophil branch. So that makes also sense because many of these genes are actually part of the innate immune system. So in fact, 39 of these 170 differentially variable genes are in the pathway innate immune system. So these become expressed during granulocyte differentiation. So that leads to the hypothesis that actually these cells might be rerouted from granulocyte precursor states towards the erythrocyte branch. And that could explain the fact that we see an expansion of the erythrocyte branch, but no change in overall cell count in the bone marrow. So now I want to briefly talk about a second example where we also applied this method. I'm seeing I'm almost running out of time, but maybe in 5 minutes I can try to show you this because I think it's important that we are seeing these effects are not unique to the bone marrow. So I told you about the intestinal epithelium, where the intestinal stem cell gives rise to absorptive enterocytes, which are highly abundant in that epithelium, and a number of secretory cell types, which are in fact rare cell types, in particular enteroendocrine cells, which further segregate into many different hormone producers. So we took data from a study by Aviv Rigev from 2017 and analyzed them using VAR-ID. And again, clustering on the prune nearest neighbor network turns out to be much more sensitive. So in particular, for the enteroendocrine cells, the hormone producers, we get many more subtypes here. And looking at marker genes, we can see that we nicely resolve all these different hormone producers, while this is not the case if you perform the clustering on the Fulke nearest neighbor network. Again, we can also compute transition probabilities from these link probabilities, and that reflects that the secretory lineages arise directly from the stem cell compartment, from the LGR5 positive cells, and don't go through that transit amplifying compartment that gives rise to the abundant enterocytes. So we looked into the differentially noisy genes in the LGR5 positive compartment, shown over here. By a similar approach as we applied in case of the bone marrow, so by taking the transcription factors and building a gene regulatory network, we found that actually lineage-determining transcription factors of secretory lineages are highly variable in the stem cell compartment, in the LGR5 positive compartment. For example, we found FOXA3, which is important for goblet cell differentiation, and for example, SOX4 and TOX3, which are involved in Tuft cell or enteroendocrine cell differentiation. And here is some concrete examples. So TOX3, you can recognize here, it's upregulated. So here's a gene expression. So it's upregulated in these secretory progenitors, but the noise level is elevated in the stem cell compartment. And the same is true for HOPX, which is actually also expressed in the Tuft cell branch. So this also shows increased noise in the stem cell population. So again, it seems that there is fluctuating lineage-determining transcription factor networks within the stem cell population. So it could be that this is a common feature of stem cells, that they have this variable activity of these transcription factor networks. So with that, I would like to come to an end. And I hope I could convince you that biological variability, that gene expression variability encodes well, biologically meaningful information, such as fluctuations of lineage-determining GRNs in stem cells. Then also, it's important to note that we actually amplify signals from lowly expressed genes as we are integrating information across these local neighborhoods. And then we found that gene expression noise is dynamically regulated in a systematic fashion during differentiation. And that opens the door for further research, obviously. So our future goals and questions are, first of all, to improve the noise quantification for lowly expressed genes. Then we would like to further study the function of noise during differentiation, and in particular address how these noisy genes are integrated into gene regulatory networks. So with that, I would like to acknowledge the people from my lab. So I talked about FADE-ID, which was worked by Josef Perman in particularly. So the second part, so the main part of the talk, VAR-ID, so that was actually my own project that I had. But of course, I had many contributions also from people in my lab. And in general, this is a very nice group of people, and I enjoy working with them a lot. I also want to acknowledge all my funders and thank you for your attention. And I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you so much, Dominique, for a great talk. There are a lot of questions for you. The majority of you have written them on the questions list, but please raise your hand also if you have questions, and I will also go through them. So let me see. Wait a minute. I need to order you.
Should I stop the slide sharing, or should I leave?
It's up to you, as you want. Maybe we leave it on in case. So I have a question. Come on.
So I can ask a question while you look, Maria, if you don't mind.
No, I'm there, but I will keep you on the list, Fabian.
Damn.
I have a question
from Maria. Okay, I shut up.
I have a question from Maria Richter that says, STEM-ID requires a homogeneous KNN graph. Does it mean that you cannot look at heterogeneous cells that would determine each other's cell fate through cell communication? I don't fully understand.
I'm also not sure if I fully understand this, first of all, I think she means var ID, because stem ID is a little bit different. So what we try to predict with var ID is the variability in the local neighborhood in cell state space, and this should rather reflect like intrinsic fluctuations of genes within the cell. Of course, there is this other factor of extrinsic signals that determine mm-hmm. the cell fate by cell-cell signaling. But this is, to me, kind of an orthogonal direction that has also been that also has to be integrated if you would like to fully understand the process of cell fate decision. And we are doing that with the help of spatial method, but it doesn't come from var ID, mm-hmm. at least not directly. So it could be, of course, that some of this variability that we observed is actually triggered by cell-cell interaction.
Yeah, and I guess this is for var ID, but also for fate ID should also be relevant, I guess. I don't know. Next question from Malte Lücken. When you prune corrections in var ID, you assume that genes in neighboring cells should have similar Pearson residuals. How do you deal with lowly expressed genes where the negative binomial model fit can be poor and thus you are more likely to have outliers? Do you only look at highly variable genes or highly expressed genes for pruning?
Well, I'm not using the Pearson residuals for the pruning. So the Pearson residuals, they're only used to perform the PCA and then actually to determine the K nearest neighbors. But mm-hmm. the noise is actually modeled based on the raw UMIs.
Okay. Yeah. Okay.
Once I have the neighbors, I look into the distribution of UMIs again, because for mm-hmm. the Pearson residuals, I'm not sure if we have a good statistical model.
Yeah. Then another question by Yu Cao. Have you used the KNN network to a more specific cell type, for example, T cells, to reveal the potential connection of the subtypes of T cells? If so, how was the performance? And if not, what are the major challenges?
Well, I think in general, these K nearest neighbor networks, they work very well. So even without pruning, we all know this. I mean, ScanPy and Sierra, so these are the major methods that are based on KNN. And they have shown in many examples, also in particular for T cells, that we are, have a very good ability to discriminate cell types and identify lineages. So the pruned version of this, we haven't applied yet to T cell data. But mm-hmm. this is, of course, an interesting point, as they are very similar, but they could have important differences between particular substates.
Okay. Question by Marcel Schultz. How did you create the TF network in the var ID part, based on expression similarity?
I didn't say this. So we used Gini3 based on normalized gene expression. And this is the random forest regression again. And Gini3 has also now been, it's integrated in different methods like Scenic, and then in the benchmark comparison, it has been shown to work very well. And actually, I have to say, in many of our projects, we have found it to work really well.
There is a question by Karsten Marr, but I will unmute him because he raised his hand. So, Karsten, you should be able to talk now.
Hey, Dominique. Thank you very much for this great talk. Thanks. Have a question to the gene regulatory networks you make up. Are they composed based on only the highly variable genes or all transcription factors which are important. And second question, are there any clear correlations to epigenetic marks that might be responsible for the high noise in those genes?
Yeah, so first, to answer your first question, so so we took only the highly variable genes, so the genes that were differentially variable according to VAR-ID, and right. then we sub-selected the transcription factors, and on okay. those we built this network.
Nice.
And then the second question was so epigenetic marks. So yeah, so this is something that we look currently into in more detail, if you find specific variability patterns of epigenetic regulators. But this I cannot talk about right now because it's a bit premature. But this is one of the obvious questions to figure out if there is more involved in the regulation of gene expression variability.
Thanks, Dominic.
Very interesting. Another question from someone that raised a hand from Svetlana, I will unmute her now. You could talk now.
Hi, Dominique.
Hi, so, Svetlana.
Yeah, you mentioned it briefly, but I'm a bit puzzled about RNA splicing in metabolic genes, because if thinking about like biologist's point of view, they are genes which are usually really stable. So to introduce noise into them, because they have stable transcript, even if you change transcription rate, it's going to take a lot of time to change it. So I'm a bit puzzled that you actually see them. Maybe I misunderstood that point.
yeah, but it doesn't mean that they have high variability. They just have a specific variability pattern. So they were in this module 2 where actually variability goes down during differentiation. So they are variable in the stem cell compartment, and this could indicate, again, the presence of states that have a different splicing activity and that may give rise to different lineages. But then eventually, as you differentiate towards neutrophils, actually they become very stable. So that, in terms of what you say, would then also make sense, I believe.
Thanks. Interesting.
Thanks. I guess now we could go to Fabian. Fabian, you can unmute yourself and ask your question.
Thanks. Nice presentation. Really great, Dominic.
Thank you, Fabian.
A summary of also parts of your just recent Nature Methods paper. I was wondering, so you had this one point, and I haven't heard about that before. I mean, I didn't see in the paper that you said that the covariance of genes, because I think you aggregated them in those clusters, right? So this covariance pattern was potentially driving some of those decisions, sort of reaching a tipping a point. Is that really covariance of genes? So for example, you know, remember these old classical models of one transcription factor inhibiting the other and vice versa, this bistable switch that maybe potentially drives decisions, this old Pugata motive, and there have been others, I think, in hematopoiesis. You wouldn't aggregate those in the same thing. So there would be a different, so it would be a joint strong covariance, but you wouldn't cluster them together. So would you miss that?
This was just something. Well, it was just actually to give this idea. So this is nothing that we believe for this module in particular. So I think they can be things. So they can be particular covariation patterns as you turn out, and then this mutual inhibition, so that it introduces P stability, for example. That is one of them. But then, I mean, I pointed this out more in terms of the variability. Because this indicates that there might be like a global change in variability during differentiation. But this is more
a long time, right? As you plotted in your UMAP.
So we are now looking also in detail into covariance patterns actually. But this was not really part of this presentation yet. But this is a really important question, not only the variability per se, but in fact, maybe even more the covariability between genes. Yeah.
So maybe just going beyond only variability goes up, maybe it really becomes bistable or something like that. There could be more refined measures for that, right?
Yeah, a lot of work to be done in the future. That's good for us.
Thank you. We have many more typed questions, so I will continue reading them. From Georg Fühlen, transcriptional noise in developmental processes could be quite different from noise due to aging processes. Did you or someone that you're aware of ever look into aging processes using your tools?
Yeah, so not yet, but this is definitely on the list. So there's different organs where we are planning to do this. So the bone marrow is in a very interesting case because there it's also known that the cells change their lineage bias during aging. And then also the liver, which is an organ that we study, there it will also be interesting to figure out how the function of the liver and its cellular architecture is affected during aging. So we haven't done this, but this is definitely an interesting topic.
From Scott Lacadi, the question is, have you tried to look at the relationship between variability in gene expression noise and promoter accessibility dynamics using published data sets? I guess it's a bit like Karsten's question. Have you correlated the noise variability with the epigenome?
Not yet. I mean, there's so many things to do, but that's also definitely a high priority. So I think it will be really interesting to see how these noisy genes, how they're actually regulated on the chromatin level, if they're like typically open or if they're also noisy on the chromatin level. And then we might also need to think about models for noise on the chromatin level, which will be much harder due to the sparsity of the data.
Yeah. Another question by Kritza Dakar and Chai Chompu says, you mentioned at some point about using self-organizing map. Could you explain more details? What is, for what purpose you would use it?
Well, we basically use them to group the gene expression profiles, so the noise profiles by similarity into different neurons or nodes, if you want. Yeah.
Okay, so I guess the question is more like, why a self-organizing map? How does it scale?
Well, because it worked very well. So okay. for us, it worked much better than using k-means or hierarchical clustering. So that was just the best approach in our hands.
Okay, we have two more questions. Fidel Ramirez, do you know if the estimation of gene expression noise is affected by the single cell library preparation method?
Yes, I would really assume that. So that you also see when you run VAR-ID, you have to be a bit careful because ideally you run it on data from one experiment where you have limited systematic differences between libraries. Since it's a method that is based on raw UMI counts, you also cannot really use batch correction methods. If you do that, then often you get like many, many clusters because actually then the VAR-ID method finds that that neighbors have inconsistent UMI estimates or UMI levels. And this then can come from dominant library batch effects. This may be also lined for future improvements, how to get rid of these effects, but it's not as straightforward.
Yeah, very, very good point. Another question from Subhash Balsami. While you analyze the variants or covariants of a particular gene to find the critical point of commitment, how do you handle the inherent noise present in the data? I guess this is the fit that you do of the variants versus mean, no?
Yeah, well, so for the variability, yes. And for the covariance, we don't have a specific method to remove that noise because I wouldn't know how. I mean, maybe you can try imputing, but that may also then defeat the purpose. Mm-hmm. So here we're just calculating local correlations or local covariances. Mm-hmm. But there might also be room for better ways to go. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I would have a question myself, and that would be the last one. On your fade ID, stem ID, did you put the velocity on top of it or metabolic labeling? Did you see whether the velocity arrows or the metabolic labeling delta RNA helps you on your or confirms your connections?
Yeah, so I had this discussion with Fabian already. We're working a lot with hematopoietic system, and for some reason, the arrows are often inverted for the hematopoietic system, and I still didn't really understand why that is. Yeah. So on other systems, it works well. So on the liver, we see it's kind of consistent, but there's also systems where we see like a complementary picture of what we would expect. But that may depend on the selection of the genes, I guess. So I think one has to spend more time looking into this and maybe focus on the genes that are known to be important for lineage decision. But then it's also biased, right? So
you mean only use those for the velocity, yeah. Okay. Well, very interesting. I think it was a great talk, great questions from everyone. Thank you so much, Dominique. And everyone, remember that in 2 weeks we will have Celia Martinez Jimenez, and we hope that you will be here again. So have a good Friday. Bye bye.
Thank you very much to everyone. Bye.
Bye.